later this morning. At communion, we continue to receive bread only, so please come forward and keep your mask on throughout the time of receiving the bread, and then you can return to your seat and consume the bread there. We come around with the chalice because some of us like to touch the chalice or just include the chalice in our prayers, even though we're not actually serving wine yet. It's so good to see you and be with you today. Come, all you people, with songs of praise. Come, all you people seeking justice and peace. Come, all you people, our God is near.
Thank you.
Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, you declare your almighty power chiefly in showing mercy and pity. Grant us the fullness of your grace, that we, running to obtain your promises, may become partakers of your heavenly treasure through Jesus Christ our Lord.
A reading from the book of Numbers. The rabble among them had a strong craving, and the Israelites also wept again and said, "If only we had meat to eat. We remember the fish we used to eat in Egypt for nothing, the cucumbers, the melons, the leeks, the onions, and the garlic. But now our strength is dried up, and there is nothing at all but this manna to look at." Moses heard the people weeping throughout their families, all at the entrances of their tents. Then the Lord became very angry, and Moses was displeased. So Moses said to the Lord, "Why have you treated your servant so badly? Why have I not found favor in your sight, that you lay the burden of all this people on me? Did I conceive all this people? Did I give birth to them? That you should say to me, 'Carry them in your bosom as a nurse carries a sucking child to the land that you promised on oath to their ancestors'? Where am I to get meat to give to all this people? For they come weeping to me and say, 'Give us meat to eat.' I am not able to carry all this people alone, for they are too heavy for me. If this is the way you're going to treat me, put me to death at once. If I have found favor in your sight, and do not let me see my misery." So the Lord said to Moses, "Gather for me 70 of the elders of Israel, whom you know to be the elders of the people and officers over them. Bring them to the tent of the meeting and have them take their place there with you." So Moses went out and told the people the words of the Lord, and he gathered 70 elders of the people and placed them all around the tent. Then the Lord came down in the cloud and spoke to him and took some of the spirit that was on him and put it on the 70 elders. And when the spirit rested upon them, they prophesied, but they did not do it again. Two men remained in the camp, one named Eldad and the other named Medad, and the spirit rested on them. They were among those who registered. But they had not gone out to the tent, and so they prophesied in the camp. And a young man ran and told Moses, "Eldad and Medad are prophesying in the camp." And Joshua, son of Nun, the assistant of Moses, one of his chosen men, said, "My lord Moses, stop them." But Moses said to him, "Are you jealous for my sake? Would that all the Lord's people were prophets, and that the Lord would put his spirit on them." The word of the Lord.
Please join in the psalm. We'll start with the classroom side and then respond from the Walker Hall side. The law of the Lord is perfect and revives my soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure and gives wisdom to the innocent. The statutes of the Lord are just and rejoice the heart. The commandment of the Lord is clear and gives light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean and endures forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, more than much fine gold, sweeter far than honey in the comb. By them also is your servant enlightened, and in keeping them there is great reward. Who can tell how often he offends? Cleanse me from my secret faults. Above all, keep your servant from presumptuous sins. Let them not get dominion over me. Then I shall be whole and sound, and innocent of great offense. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and redeemer.
A reading from James. Are any among you suffering? They should pray. Are any cheerful? They should sing songs of praise. Are any among you sick? They should call for the elders of the church and have them pray over them, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. The prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise them up, and anyone who has committed sins will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. The prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective. Elijah was a human being like us, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain. And for 3 years and 6 months, it did not rain on the earth. Then he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth yielded its harvest. My brothers and sisters, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and is brought back by another, you should know that whoever brings back a sinner from wandering will save the sinner's soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark. John said to Jesus, "Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, And we tried to stop him because he was not following us. But Jesus said, "Do not stop him, for no one who does a deed of power in my name will be able soon afterward to speak evil of me. Whoever is not against us is for us. For truly I tell you, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you bear the name of Christ will by no means lose the reward. If any of you put a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you if a great millstone were hung around your neck and you were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life maimed than to have two hands and to go to hell, to the unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life lame than to have 2 feet and to be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have 2 eyes and to be thrown into hell, where their worm never dies and the fire is never quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its saltiness, how can you season it? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another." The Gospel of the Lord. Let's talk about hellfire. Nobody really wants to, I'm almost sure of it. At best, hellfire is a dated, cartoonish notion from yesteryear. Or it's the kind of thing people think of in a ho-hum, thoughtless way. Go to hell, you might say to someone. But you're not really being serious or literal. But at worst, hellfire is abusive and traumatic. I have a friend who grew up in a part of the country that provided his childhood imagination with plenty of religious material to feel scared about, even terrified about. Even now in midlife, he can feel haunted by the horrible, inhumane warning that if he does the wrong thing, or if he thinks the wrong thing, he will be sent to hell when he dies. And hell is a furnace of eternal hellfire. I want no part of that. If that is what hell is, then I tell you, there is no such thing as hell. We can just collect all those images and ideas and wrap them up and toss them in the trash. They are worthless at best and grotesquely harmful at worst. Forget them. But hellfire or hell, they could still be images or ideas that fascinate us and spur us to do some healthy reflection. One of our Anglican forebears in the faith and in theology, C.S. Lewis, removes all the fire imagery, and he imagines hell as a vast gray town where everyone lives miles apart because in hell, having a neighbor is intolerable. And no one is happy, but they nonetheless are there by choice. For Lewis, hell is the place where I get to do whatever I want and serve only my own needs, and not have any relationships with anybody else, because relationships are costly. The other person inevitably will need something from me, or cost me something, or they could break my heart, or I could break theirs. And so I may freely choose to be alone, free from all obligations and all danger of heartbreak. C.S. Lewis calls that hell. But he is insightful. He knows that hell has an upside. I am miserable and lonely, yes, but I am not heartbroken. I am living an empty life, but I'm not hurting the way I would if I were vulnerable to you. I'm miserable, but I'm not wrong. Nobody is forcing me to be a better or different person. And so Lewis intriguingly says this. He says, "The doors to hell are locked from the inside." And that is one kind of hell or hellfire that I want to talk about. Not the cartoon version or the terrifying threat that psychopaths in religious garments preach to terrorize their congregants. No, but this version. The hellfire that I choose, the hellfire that rises around me and scorches my soul when I choose to step away from you and from our neighbor until the flames of selfishness consume me with loneliness and despair. But there's a second kind of hellfire that's also well worth talking about. I can condemn myself to a hellish existence, yes. But I can also send my neighbor, if not to hell exactly, then into a hellish experience. I can plunge my neighbor into a form of hellfire. In a few moments, we will confess, in kind of hard language, we'll confess the evils we have done, but we will also confess the evils done on our behalf. My care and feeding, my shelter and my clothing, my water and electrical supplies, my ability to move by automobile, all the access I have to the means of production, to creature comforts, to bank accounts, to seats on airplanes, all the ways that I live and move in my life, all of that is connected to the lives and the livelihoods of others, and it potentially damages them. I have a carbon footprint. I live and work on land that was forcibly taken from someone who lived there first. I am a person with white privilege, and therefore I can choose whether or not to care about that privilege, or work on it, or act consciously to blunt its impact on other people. And that's just one of many privileges that I have. And so, yes, I can choose a hellish existence in which I am my own God, and nobody else really matters in my life. But I can choose a kind of hell for others, too, simply by going about my business without consciously working on my ethical place in the world. Jesus cuts across all of this, and he uses sharp language and vivid energy to get through to us. He does not want us to live in that horrible gray town, and he definitely doesn't want us sending anyone else there. He uses hyperbole, wild exaggeration, to get our attention. All those startling lines about cutting out our eyes and cutting off our hands. He wants us to stop putting stumbling blocks in front of little ones who believe in him. He is urgent and earnest about this. We should listen. Now we need to understand more fully the term little ones, lest we think that he's only warning us against putting stumbling blocks in the path of adorable little children. It is more accurate to understand that by little ones, Jesus means lots of different people. He means neophytes in his movement. He also means people who lack privilege or status because they are female or in a different religious or ethnic group, or they are physically different in some way, or they're carriers of disease, or they're lower on the socioeconomic ladder. So yes, little ones does include children. Particularly in our own time of history when so many children are vulnerable to so much injustice, violence, and oppression. But it also means many, many more people. It means newcomers here at Grace, certainly, but also those who do not feel welcome here and who doubt that we have any interest in welcoming them. It means people who lack economic or education privilege, people who lack cisgender, male, or white privilege. People our culture decides are too old, or too unattractive, or too sick, or too unworthy for any reason to be treated with dignity and respect. If we choose not to reach out to our neighbors, particularly those Jesus points to, as ones the world ignores or abuses, then we are choosing a hellish existence for ourselves. And potentially a hellish experience for others too. Everyone is damaged. On this point, Jesus seems to be giving us a sharp warning, not a warm invitation. Beware, Jesus seems to be saying. My easy pattern of unconscious participation in systems of oppression and abuse. This is damaging everyone, including me. But Jesus is invitational. Because he knows that we don't have to listen. He does not threaten us with the judgment of hellfire. He only alerts us to the hellfire we bring upon ourselves and upon others when we choose not to seek justice in this world. He wants us to choose justice, to choose life. In C.S. Lewis's story about the gray town of hell, in his little book called The Great Divorce, he imagines several residents of hell getting on a bus and traveling to the edge of heaven. These lonely and angry souls, so damaged by their misery, they are not yet strong enough to handle the intensity of heaven proper. And so they can only lurk around at the edge of that bright land. Once they arrive there, one of them is met by a resident of heaven, a person who on earth happened to be his wife. Lewis calls her one of the blessed ones. Filled with God's love and light, she greets her earthly husband after he gets off the bus. She's still doing the emotional labor in their marriage at this particular moment. And she invites him to go back with her into the mountains, into the presence of God. But there's a problem. To move forward into heaven and to truly leave hell, he has to let go of things he holds dear. He has to let go of resentment. He has to let go of his own sense of self-righteousness. He has to, using Jesus imagery, he has to metaphorically cut off or gouge out the parts of himself that keep him small and petty and self-centered. In our reading of Lewis's story, through our lens, he has to consciously set aside privilege. But he mostly just has to let go and trust somebody else and stop making everything about himself. This gives him great pause. Like many of us, this poor man has discovered that hellfire is awful enough, but it is comfortable too. It is the devil he knows. The Blessed One persists for a long time. She, like Jesus himself, is forceful and earnest. She wants to get through to this soul who seems to be insisting on dooming himself to hell. The words she says to him are what Christ himself says to us even now, this morning, here at the edge of paradise, as we gather here to pray for wisdom and understanding, as we gather here to pray for God's little ones here and across the world. She says this to her poor, hell-bound husband, and she says this to us. Dear, no one sends you back. Here is all joy. Everything bids you stay. Please stand. Together, let us affirm our faith. We believe in God above us, maker and sustainer of all life, of sun and moon, of water and earth, of all humanity. We believe in God beside us, Jesus Christ, the Word made flesh, born of a woman's womb, servant of the poor. He was tortured and nailed to a tree. Knowing full passion and deep sorrow, he died forsaken. He descended into the earth to the place of death. On the third day, he rose from the tomb. He ascended into heaven to be everywhere present, and his kingdom will one day be known. We believe in God within us, the Holy Spirit of Pentecostal fire, life-giving breath of the church. She is the Spirit of healing and forgiveness, source of resurrection and of life everlasting. Amen.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Let us pray for the church, the world, and all who carry heavy burdens. God, in your mercy, we pray for Grace Church in transition, for all who call this their spiritual home, for all people of faith and all whose faith is known to God alone. Teach us to love one another and to follow after things which make for peace. God, in your mercy, we pray for this nation and our leaders, and for all nations, especially all who are suffering the impact of extreme weather. Give us strong voices to advocate for all who suffer injustice, disruption, violence, and oppression. God, in your mercy, we pray for all people in need and for all who long for companionship, hope, and healing. Strengthen us to visit, console, and encourage them. We pray especially for those on our prayer list. We pray for healing for Leslie, Nancy, John, Kate, Ted, Elizabeth, Nicole and baby Miles, Ron, David, Mark, Claire and baby, Charles, Eli, Stacy, Glenna, Elise, Dave, Susan, Nell, baby Lennon, Beverly, Marianne, Garth, Brian, Marguerite M., Carson, Julie, Doug, Mike, Barbara, Rich, Len, Susie, Ken, and Dina. We pray for support for Joni, Alan, Kathy, Andrew, Mario, and Susan, Terry and Ivor's family, Debbie and the Hill family, Flory, Kathy, Jim, Luke, and Mark, Justin, Sue, Theo, Susan, Ann, Mark, and Graham, Mackenzie, Ken, and Susan, Chuck, Brittany, and Evan, Ron, Martha, Peggy, and Nancy, Gary, Alyssa, and Ashley, Tracy, Rhonda, Cheryl, and Poppy, Robin, Beth, Marge, Paul, Dave, and Steph. We ask for prayers of peace for Judy, Shannon, and Mark. And we give thanks for the life of Ivor and Mary. God, in your mercy, we pray in thanksgiving for all who have died and for those who mourn. Embrace them with your wounded hands and breathe your peace upon them. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. God of all mercy, we confess that we have sinned against you, opposing your will in our lives. We have denied your goodness in each other, in ourselves, and in the world you have created. We repent of the evil that enslaves us, of what we have done, and the evil done on our behalf. Forgive, restore, and strengthen us through our Savior, Jesus Christ, that we may abide in your love and serve only your will. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through the grace of Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Peace. So good to have you here. It's good to have you. Next week I want 10 more kids. Yeah. That's right. That's enough. Peace. Hi. Peace, Terry. Peace. Peace. Oh. Oh, okay. No sweat. And we're totally fine. Yeah, don't, we can just forget to tell her. Yeah. All but the plates. Yeah. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us an offering and sacrifice to God. Please stand. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We praise you and we bless you, holy and gracious God, source of life abundant. From before time you made ready the creation. Your spirit moved over the deep and brought all things into being. Sun, moon, and stars, earth, wind, and waters, and every living thing. You made us in your image and taught us to walk in your ways, but we rebelled against you and wandered far away. And yet, as a mother cares for her children, you would not forget us. Time and again, you called us to live in the fullness of your love. And so this day, we join with saints and angels in the chorus of praise, that rings through eternity, lifting our voices to magnify you as we sing. And honor and praise to you, holy and living God, to deliver us from the power of sin and death, and to reveal the riches of your grace, you looked with favor upon Mary, your willing servant, that she might conceive and bear a son, Jesus, the Holy Child of God. Living among us, Jesus loved us. He broke bread with outcasts and sinners, healed the sick, and proclaimed good news to the poor. He yearned to draw all the world to himself. Yet we were heedless of his call to walk in love. Then the time came for him to complete upon the cross the sacrifice of his life and to be glorified by you. On the night before he died for us, Jesus was at table with his friends. He took bread, gave thanks to you, broke it, and gave it to them, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." As supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine. Again, he gave thanks to you, gave it to them, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Now gathered at your table, O God of all creation, and remembering Christ, crucified and risen, who was and is to come, we offer you our gifts of bread and wine, and ourselves a living sacrifice. Pour out your Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the body and blood of Christ. Breathe your Spirit over the whole earth and make us your new creation, the body of Christ given for the world you have made. In the fullness of time, bring us with all your saints from every tribe and language and people and nation to feast at the banquet prepared from the foundation of the world. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen." Hallelujah. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the peace. Hallelujah.
The gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Eternal God, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. At this time, I invite anyone to come forward who would like us to celebrate with them a birthday or anniversary that they are keeping today or this week. I know that we are all giving thanks for the birth of a young child named Stevie, and she is safely delivered and has been on this earth for one day. If you are on Zoom and you enter a birthday or anniversary into chat, your ambassador Ruth will come forward to read them for us. Marcy and Gary, what brings you here? The 41st anniversary, just getting started. Mm-hmm. 39 years old and seven. Daphne.
Our granddaughter Una turned 1 year old last week.
Great. Great. 1 year old, Una, appropriately named. Great. Sue Maxwell, 85. Dana. Okay. Happy birthday. This is quite a lot of pressure. Yeah. Oh, and we have a shawl to bless. Let us pray. O God, you are the conqueror of time, and all generations rise and fall before you. We give you thanks for these your servants who celebrate another year and another year together. Fill them with your grace and your power. Send them into this world with broken, open hearts and with joy to proclaim your good news. Bless also this shawl, the hands that put this shawl into place for us, and the person who will use it in their daily life of prayer. Shower your blessings upon all of us as we sing shouts of praise to you. Amen. Blessing of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of Hagar and of Ishmael. The blessing of God who took human form, shared our burdens, and trampled down death by death. The God whose spirit drives us with wind and fire into this good world, be among you now and remain with you always. Thank you. two things to share with you for the life of the community. Please have a seat, and it will be brief, and then we'll dismiss you. I want to call on our warden, Daphne, who is where she needs to be right at this particular moment. I'm calling on Rachel Brandt, which is what I had planned to do all along. Make sure the mic is on. There you go.
Hey, howdy!
Well. Thank you for asking. Yes, I am. And right now, I'm enjoying a quiet cup of tea. But aren't you Gifts of the Dirt, Peggy Ashcroft?
Why, yes, I am Gifts of Dirt, darling Peggy Ashcroft. I've just been sitting over here quietly or lustily praising the Lord.
Well,
let me join you up there, because I appear to be talking to myself.
Well, yes. I joined my sister years ago to be part of parish life. And then I couldn't stand it when those grace people called her the party maven of Bainbridge Island.
I, on the other hand, instead of having parties, decided to plant a garden. God had spoken into my ear, so I got a bunch of people together. We all got down on our knees in the dirt and planted stuff. And we grew thousands of tons of food for Healthline. So at the same time I was doing parish life, I was growing food. And what were you doing?
Well, even though I'm a pretty refined gal, Fun is my middle name. Peggy Fun Ashcroft. So I toiled for years to achieve my crowning accomplishment, the Douse the Priest event at homecoming this year. It was the best. And after that, it was going to be all downhill. So, I hung up my parish life title.
Bummer.
Well, even though you have hung up your parish life title, Peggy Ashcroft, we know that I, Peggy Ashcroft, will still keep the garden growing, and your partner in parish life previously, and your two sides of yourselves, and everybody in Grace, what we want to do is take off our hats to you and thank you for many, many years of work as the parish life minister. Thank you so, so much.
For she's a jolly good fellow, for she's a jolly good fellow, which nobody can deny.
We have one more short announcement, Cindy and Heather.
morning. I'm Heather Parr, and Cindy Logan, your outreach co-chairs. And as is our tradition, on the fourth Sunday of every month, we focus our outreach efforts on serving one of our ministry partners by doing a project here right after the service. So we invite you to join us immediately after we adjourn under the eaves. We're going to be assembling some hygiene products that we've gathered for our ministry partner, Chaplains on the Harbor. Do you want to introduce James?
I am very pleased to introduce James, who has come all the way from Chaplains on the Harbor to join us and bring a little bit of his story. And then he's going to join us and help assemble and pack the things we have gathered. So, James.
Okay. So Chaplains on the Harbor, I don't know if anyone knows exactly where that is, but C.S. Lewis kind of described it pretty well. It's a little gray town and all your friends are miles away. But anyway, yeah, I drove up from Aberdeen, and so I was asked to be here with Aaron, who last minute, last night, was like, hey, you're going to be there in person by yourself. So I don't have multiple Jameses to introduce me today, but I'm kind of jealous of the multi-Peggies that were there. that was admirable. So I work with Chaplains on the Harbor. I started in, I believe, 2000, like the end of 17, 18. And we have a farm out in Montesano, where we grow fresh produce like cabbage and broccoli and all that. And I have to explain that because anytime I say I work at a farm, people act like vegetables don't usually grow on farms. Like they're like, oh, you work at one of those green farms. And I'm like, what? No, I work at a veggie farm. We have carrots and potatoes and you can eat our food. Like it's a great thing. You should look it up. They've been around. So that is what I get to do weekly. We also have our chaplain work, which is we go out and do like outreach with people on the street, and we meet people where they're at and try to help them assist with their needs. In the winter, we have a cold weather shelter out in Westport, and we have like a few people stay the night. And it's just been a real blessing to be able to be part of that project, because I've lived on the streets before plenty of times, most of my 20s actually, and being able to help put a roof over someone's head and just have a safe place for people to go and sleep at night puts a lot of joy in my heart, and it's just the right thing to do in my book. And so we do that. This job has been able to save my life. It brought a home for me. I finally have clothes that I paid for. I don't live clothing bank to clothing bank anymore. I have two boys that I recently brought home. They were actually in CPS care for like 3 years. And they've been home for almost two now, so that's been a blessing. Which was like a real trial when they first came around, was like right when we got hit with COVID. So my first year getting my kids into school, they're like, by the way, this is how we're doing it now. And I joked with my mom, I would be like, you know, I feel like from here on out, every back to school week is just gonna be that much easier. So anyway, I'm here just to come and check out how things are going, and I guess there's help. And thank you, Aaron, for sending me on this wonderful trip miles away from home. And I made it here, though, and I'm glad to be here, and this has been great. So thank you, guys.
Thank you. Again, please be welcome to join us in our service Sunday, and special thanks to Heather and Cindy, who are doing a fantastic job leading us in all of our outreach ministries. A tremendous bulwark of strength and courage here at Grace. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.